countless Christians around the globe, the word Haringey evokes a flood of sacred memories. For 12 eventful weeks in 1954, this rather inaccessible sports arena was transformed into a contemporary cathedral. And a call for aggressive evangelism captured the fancy of London, and then the world. Could it happen again? The bustling tempo of Piccadilly is reflected in the first floor Crusade offices at number 225. Here, during the strategic months ahead, the momentous task of mobilizing hundreds of churches, thousands of prayer partners, choir members, stewards, and scores of other behind-the-scenes workers will be expedited. This will be the programming center for the spring councillor training classes to be scattered throughout the greater London area. Volunteer workers are assuming the responsibility of informing concerned Christians everywhere of the month-by-month planning and progress. Crusade director, the Reverend Walter Smith, and his associate director, Mr. Bill Brown, will be guiding the overall decisions in the crucial days of preparation that lie ahead. Hours of prayerful attention have been devoted to the Crusade setting. Court has been booked for the duration of the crusade. Centrally located on many underground lines, the arena's extended seating capacity of 27,000 is a vast improvement over Haringey.
I believe we clergy need to thrill and challenge our people with this coming crusade in 66 as a really possible bridge between the men and the man of the street, if you like, who sometimes thinks very little about Christian things, and a real personal commitment to Christ. The ordinary man in the street, the man tramping the pavement, the man running for his bus and marching for his train and catching the tube, these are the men I believe we're going to reach with the gospel. Now there's one big difficulty here. The ordinary man in the street thinks that the Christian faith is irrelevant. He doesn't really see it as something which touches his life, his home, his family, his personal problems and difficulties. And I believe that Billy Graham's work has had this note of relevance and of reality, not just pie in the sky, as we used to say, but so relating the claim of Jesus Christ to our lives that men become indeed new men in Christ when they meet with Christ. Now, what are our people, if I'm speaking now as a clergyman, what are our people going to do about this? The ordinary man in the pew, how is he going to present the gospel to the ordinary man in the street? Seems to me that the 66 Crusade is going to present us with a massive opportunity in which we're going to be able to get all the coverage we want from press and television and radio. It'll be free because they'll want it. Now, I remember in 54 and 55 that Billy Graham was news, but this meant that the Christian gospel was news, and this meant that it was an easy thing, wherever we happened to be, to talk about it. I believe the man in the pew has got to get to the man in the street and tell him the Christian faith is relevant from his own experience and encourage him to come and hear Billy present the faith simply, clearly, cogently, persuasively, and with decision. Men have got to face the call of decision to accept Christ as Saviour and as Lord, and to see that the Christian faith isn't just a way of finding a way to heaven in the future, but a way of finding life at its best as well as life everlasting. Life at its best now. You probably know that the Church of England recently, in the Church Assembly, asked all the members of the Church of England to pray for the Billy Graham Crusade. This has been followed by requests in the same sort of way in other denominations in our country. And I believe there's an opportunity for a great burden of prayer to be laid upon the hearts of Christian people in our country to pray for the Graham Crusade. Now, I know some people think, of course, that evangelism is something which is emotional and doesn't last. Now, 12 years after the Haringey Crusade, in my own theological college where I'm principal, out of the 70 or 75 men we have there, 7 of them are men who in those days were converted to Christ, have gone on into Christian service, and have now begun to prepare for whole-time service in the ministry. This is something that lasts.
One day my sister came home and she had an invitation to go to Haringey to hear Billy Graham. Well, I just pooh-poohed the idea. Some American telling Britain what to do. It wasn't for me.
I was sent to prison for 5 years. How I got there would take too long to say and could quite easily fill a book.
My mother became a prayer partner in preparation for the meetings. She sought to interest me in Dr. Billy Graham's ministry and the crusade itself, but only succeeded in fact to antagonize me against Dr. Billy Graham and Christianity in general.
When I was 11, my sister took me along to Haringey, where I heard Dr. Billy Graham talk about Jesus and accepted Christ as my saviour. But I didn't grow in the faith because my home life was very difficult.
When I got to Haringey, I remember feeling very awkward indeed, because I'd expected to see there a whole lot of old ladies and tramps, down-at-heel people, instead of which there was this great crowd of well-dressed, some many of them young people. And to cover up my awkwardness, I remember with the young lady who I had with me making a lot of fun of everything and trying to get a good laugh out of it.
After about 3 months of being in prison, one day I had the opportunity of seeing a Billy Graham film, which was about the London Crusade, called Souls in Conflict. It was during this film that George Beverly Shea sang the words softly and tenderly, "Jesus is calling." And it was that evening, after seeing the film, that for the first time in my life, I felt that I needed someone in my life. And that night I asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come into my heart and be my savior and friend.
I resisted all that Dr. Graham said, his appeal, and came away quite certain that I would never go again, but unwittingly committed myself to a second visit. And it was on this second occasion that I committed my life to Christ and made my decision for him.
There came the moment when Beverly Shea started to sing "He's Got the Whole Wide World in His Hands." And I remember thinking as I looked at him, what a soft sort of man. Until all of a sudden he came to the moment where he sings, "He's got the tiny little baby in his hands." And he had such a look of love on his face as I'd never seen before, even on the face of my father and mother. And I believe that it was in that moment that God touched my heart for the first time.
When I was 17, I went along to another Billy Graham crusade relay. And I knew before I walked into the building that God was going to speak to me. Since that time, I have never looked back. God has helped in many ways. Monetarily and in all ways in my life, he has guided me. And shortly, I am to get married to a Christian fellow.
The church that I was connected with by the crusade follow-up procedure was St. James of Bethnal Green. And I entered into the membership of this church, learned to study the Bible, which I'd never read before, learned to serve Christ in the context of the church and in my home and at work. Then after some time, 5 years or so after my conversion, I began to feel a call to the ministry, the ordained ministry. I resisted this. It wasn't the thing that I wanted. It wasn't the thing that I felt I was suited for. But I eventually entered Oak Hill Theological College, completed my training, was ordained a few years ago, and began a curacy in St. John's, Woking, where I am now a curate.
I knew nothing about the Bible. I just didn't have a clue. I didn't even know how to start to read it. But I wrote to the man who brought the film to show us in prison, and he told me to read my Bible and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. This I did, and for the next 3 years in prison, I read my Bible daily and prayed to the Lord daily.
When Mr. Billy Graham came to the end of his message, he asked all those who wanted to decide for Christ that night to come forward. Well, I realized that this was the most important moment in my life. It meant admitting that for 30 years I'd been wasting my time, money, strength, on things that didn't matter. It meant I'd got to take my hands off my own life and put myself straight into the hands of God.
God comforts in time of stress. Even now, my mother is in hospital suffering from a stroke. But I know that what is that good and acceptable will of God will be my portion forever, now that I'm his.
On my release from prison, the Lord led me to a Christian girl who, knowing all about my background and my past life, agreed to marry me. And today we have got two wonderful children, a boy and a girl.
I look back over the years to the time when I was working as a fitter in mechanical engineering, the time just before Haringey. I marvel that God should call me into the ministry, to be a minister of the gospel.
I never before wanted to help humanity, but now I feel a deep compassion for the whole human race, and I believe they need God.
When I look at my children, my home, and my wife, I think of the words of that glorious hymn, "To God be the glory, great things he has done."
My father, mother, and sister all came to know the Lord at Haringey.
God holds the key.
Amen.
The 1954 Crusade climaxed in awesome triumph. Yet, the time for greatness, the time for going forward, cannot be consigned to history. It is not the pattern of God's promise to withhold his power. As Christians work together, pray together, and believe God together, a spiritual energy will generate that will liberate the gospel far beyond the walls of our churches, sending wave after wave of spiritual renewal across the United Kingdom. May we each find our place in this grand design for evangelizing our nation in our generations.